I'm James Kramer, Community Relations Manager here for Clowes Memorial Hall. It's a pleasure having you all here for our second to the last Clowes Conversations of this season. It's a new program for us, and it's just been wonderful to see the kind of interest there has been in the various genres of art and art forms that we've been having a deeper conversation about this season. We're going to continue this in the future, so we're welcoming any of your feedback of the kinds of things that you'd like to engage in a deeper understanding of or conversation with some of our really fine local experts in a variety of fields. A couple of things I want to mention to you, of course, the emergency procedure. We've got the exit over here, and we also have one behind you to your left. In case of emergency, just quietly go through those doors and wait for further instructions. We'll be gathering upstairs. Also, the as I mentioned, this is the second to the last conversation. We have one more in a month that will be on Tuesday, April 8th. I'll be conducting a Ballet 101. So if you or anyone that you know is always wondered about ballet or some of the insides of what goes on there and why it goes on there, and that we're going to be able to do that in conversation form, but also in an interactive form. We're going to be able to have some time if you'd like to get up and try some things. We're going to be able to do that as well. We'll be doing that in the auditorium next month. That's at 7:30 on a Tuesday night, April 8th. Our conversations have a great sponsorship, and I do need to give credit to those, and hopefully you'll appreciate their patronage as well. Of course, Butler University, of which we're a department, is a big supporter of the things that we do here. And also ArtWorks, which is the National Endowment for the Arts, the Indiana Arts Commission, the Arts Council of Indianapolis, and our media sponsors, Nuvo, WFYI, and Channel 8, or Wish TV 8. I will mention to you that we are filming this evening, and this will be available on demand on our Clowes website. We have a new tab there, so you can go back and review this or other conversations that we've had throughout the season. So when we get to time to have questions and things, our speaker and moderator this evening will repeat your questions so that we can capture that for the film, and then be able to paraphrase what we're answering. At this time, please help me welcome a wonderful, wonderful treasure that we have here at Butler University, one of our staff members who teaches as well, and she's going to be leading us through this conversation of music of South Africa, ethnomusicologist Sally Childs-Helton.
Good evening, and thank you all for coming out. We are going to be talking about the music of South Africa this evening in very broad terms, and we'll be talking a little bit about Ladysmith Black Mambaza and about Johnny Clegg and where they stand in this larger picture. But because I'm an ethnomusicologist, I like getting into the history and the culture of a country, because that really tells you in one way how the music has been shaped, and also how that environment, the cultural environment, the history has in turn shaped the music. So we're going to be looking at quite a bit of that this evening. And then later, we're going to do some hands-on. So I'm going to ask for some folks to come up here and help us, and we're going to perform a couple songs. So you'll have an idea to really get some of these chord structures and sounds really rooted in your ears. And besides, it's just a lot of fun. I'm a percussionist. I use any possible chance I can to use these colorful tuned percussion tubes, which are called boom whackers. So if any of you work with kids, work with music, I can highly recommend them, and you'll get a chance to see those in action in just a minute. I have provided you with a handout, and I have tried to put the entire history of South Africa as well as its entire music culture on one sheet of paper. And I've come close. So at least you've gotten names and terms and spellings, so that if you want to learn more about these things, you can go home and look it up. And I would encourage you to do that, if at all possible. And I am going to ask Mr. Gooch back here to go ahead and run a little bit of video. This is the introduction to Graceland. This is a concert film that Paul Simon did, and really introduced a lot of the world to South African music for the first time. This is call and response. Call and response. Call, we get the response.
Today's concert will be about the music of South Africa and the music from the Graceland album.
Gentlemen, this is Graceland in concert 1987.
Older people in the room are saying, he's so young. This guitar player is a man named Ray Feary, who's worked with Paul Simon for years. So if you want to hear what classical African pop guitar sounds like, he's the man. This is a tune called Township Jive. And is a really good example of a style called Mbakanga that Johnny Clegg plays. So you got the horn line. And this is Ladysmith Black Mombasa coming out. And please notice the footwork. And that's everything you need to know about South African music, pretty much in a nutshell. So before we get started, I want to take a quick poll. Who has seen or heard these musicians or groups? And a number of them have played here at Clowes. How about Ladysmith Black Mombasa? Some folks, Johnny Clegg, a few fewer. Miriam Makeba, Mama Africa. Hugh Masekela, great flugelhorn trumpet player, jazz player. The Mahatela Queens, they were here. And they are one of the premier examples of an Mbakanga group out there. Soweto Gospel Choir, they also were here at Clues. Who has had a chance to see the Paul Simon Graceland in full? Go home, do not delay. Rent, beg, borrow, steal a copy of Graceland. Hit Netflix, I don't care what you have to do, and watch it. Absolutely, it's one of the finest music documentaries made. And it really gives you an excellent feel for what was going on with South African music during that middle to late apartheid period. So, and for those of you who don't know, this concert was held in Zimbabwe, just across the border, because Miriam Makeba and Hugh Masekela in particular would have been arrested had they crossed the border into South Africa. In fact, Paul Simon got into some pretty deep trouble for going into South Africa to make the Graceland album in the first place. So there's a lot of politics around this. And for those of us who are old enough to remember the apartheid regime and what was going on, when we looked at that crowd, what's the first big sign that you're not in South Africa? It's an integrated mixed race crowd. Now, mind you, people traveled from all over South Africa and Zimbabwe and Central Africa and even internationally to be at that concert. But that was a pretty big hint. So we'll talk a little bit about the role of apartheid in a minute. And especially young people, who's had a chance to see The Lion King? So you've already heard Ladysmith because they were on the soundtrack. Has anybody had a chance to travel to or live in South Africa? Excellent. Excellent. Does anybody speak any South African languages? I may be asking some of you to pronounce some things for me because I do not do clicks. And they know what I'm talking about. So I will ask. Also, so you don't think I'm a total poser, as an ethnomusicologist, I do have a minor in African studies, but I'm mostly a West African specialist. So South Africa is... you know, I am learning about it just like everybody else. I do practice West African drumming and dance, so I'm doing as much hands-on and body-on learning as I can. But South Africa is not my specialty, but I'm in the ballpark. So I'm doing my best. And for those of you who have more direct hands-on and who have more experience there, please speak up and let me know. So to start with, when most people think about sub-Saharan music, the first thing they think about is drums. And in fact, the most heavily used instrument on the continent of Africa is voice. And this is especially true in South Africa. When Europeans landed in South Africa in the 1600s, they found a rich and very deeply rooted tradition of choral singing among the major groups in the area, the Zulu, the Hausa, and the Swazi. And this choral tradition still exists today and is only growing stronger. Traditionally, musical instruments were used by individuals mostly for self-expression or for entertainment, but anytime group music was made, it tended to be choral, and it still does. And the difference there is that choral music is inclusive, and that's a very important value. Another thing that we don't expect is that dancers provide their own music through choral singing, and also, those of us raised in the European tradition, this seems really odd to have dancers accompany themselves and for singers to dance. So for those of you who are musicians, I mean, can you imagine dancing and performing simultaneously? Or if you're dancers, can you imagine dancing and providing your own accompaniment? We don't do it in this culture very much, but in other cultures it's the norm, so here we are. So a lot of communal South African music is rooted in the idea of song dance, and the two really cannot be separated. They're not even separate words in some cases, so they're so deeply integrated together. Dance and gesture are considered inseparable from the music, and movement and music are blended to create what South Africans consider the highest form of artistic expression, involving the whole person and it allows integration with the entire group. So the song dance form is very much about creating and expressing community. And that's an extremely important value, and something as we look through these videos this evening, I'd like for you to keep that idea of community in your minds. So before we get a little bit deeper into this, I'd like to look a little bit at the history and culture of South Africa, because we need the context. And it's good to know the roots of these things. South Africa does take up the lowest part of the African subcontinent, and its climates range from Mediterranean to desert. It's extremely rich in natural resources, and including minerals vital to a lot of modern technology, and gold and diamonds. And this is going to become important because so many songs and dance forms that are popular today were developed in the mining camps and came out of that mining environment. South Africa was originally inhabited by two indigenous groups, the San and the Khoikhoi. And occasionally you'll hear these two groups referred to as Khoisan peoples. The San have been genetically traced back to being one of 14 core groups from which all humanity developed. So these were very, very, very early Homo sapiens. You know, these were some of our earliest ancestors are still represented by the San people of South Africa and the area just north of South Africa. Also, the Khoisan languages are important because they use clicks, they use glottal clicks. They're three click sounds? Can somebody demonstrate clicks? Just because we don't think about this. If somebody would like to come up to the microphone and demonstrate clicks, it would be wonderful. That's, please. It's one more than I can do.
So there's a C, a Q, and an X. Those are the three clicks. I think the C, if I remember correctly, is Mahuba. And then the X is Xhosa. And I'm trying to think of the other one. Oh, actually the Q was the first one I did. The C is Ntela. You kind of put your tongue against your teeth.
Thank you. Yeah, a number of years ago, Miriam Makeba came to international prominence as a folk singer, and the first song that really pulled people's ears was called the Click Song because she was singing in a click language, and it really sort of blew people's heads. So these clicks have stayed in the main language that came in with the Bantu migration. The other folks who were indigenous to the South African area, the Khoikhoi, were traditionally herders, and they lived in the Cape region, and today they've been almost totally assimilated to the rest of the population. So, very few of these folks are either the San or the Khoikhoi are living traditionally anymore. So most of them are farmers or they moved to cities. So there's not a lot of traditional life going on for these folks. Then we've got a large group of Europeans and Indians that live in South Africa. And the first Europeans to come were shipwrecked sailors. So they're sailing around the Cape and very stormy. They're shipwrecked, they land, they come back later as traders. Then the Dutch colonized South Africa in 1652, and very simply, African-born Dutch became Boers, which means farmers, and then from there, Afrikaners, the folks who basically didn't move north as farmers, became known as Afrikaners. The Dutch territories were bought out in 1814 by the British, so we have our second wave of colonization, and they became the dominant colonial power. In the mid-1800s, East Indians were brought in as slaves and as indentured servants, and also as a trader and merchant class. So, so they're also thrown into the mix. And there are also some Chinese in South Africa and persons of other Asian descent. Apartheid, too. We need to talk about apartheid. You can't talk about South Africa without talking about apartheid. This simply is the African word for separation, and it was a policy that segregated whites, blacks, and coloreds legally and geographically and every other way you can possibly separate people. So this lasted from 1948 to 1992. But colonial laws were also heavily, heavily restrictive on where people could move, where they could live, laws, things like that. So there has been separation in the country for a very, very long time. Apartheid pretty much came to an end in 1992, and Nelson Mandela was elected president in 1993. And since then, things have changed. Things have changed. To talk to you a little bit, too, about traditional music and dance. Traditional African music, again, as we said, is heavily vocal and choral, and it's performed with the singers dancing. Harmonies are based on intervals from the traditional musical bows, and that literally is a hunting bow that's played and resonated. And also, the tonal languages can help to shape melody. Many, many African languages are tonal, meaning that pitch has semantic meaning. So if you say the same set of syllables on a high-low or a low-high, they have two different meanings. So that's going to direct melodic shape. And also, a lot of people forget about the fact there's still a lot of European-based music in South Africa as well. Again, Europeans, the Portuguese, British, and Dutch, brought all their culture with them. They brought all their music with them, including church hymns. They brought organs. They brought opera. They were building opera houses. They brought orchestras, military bands, folk music, and dances. So when you talk about this this very rich culture, we can't leave out the European-based musics. In spite of the fact that many of these musics have pretty much stayed as they were or are today in whatever colonial country they came out of. So they have not been as influenced by South African music as South African music has been influenced by European and other world musics. So to get on to our 20th century and contemporary South American musics and dances, the first style I'd like to talk about is a genre that was called Mbube, which means lion in Zulu. And the genre was named after Solomon Linda's song, Mbube, which we know in the West as either Wimowe or Lion Sleeps Tonight. So what happened was when American artists started doing this song, they misunderstood the word Mbube and they heard Wimowe. So it's a misunderstanding. And so now you know what you should really be singing. And this song has a fascinating life of its own, and I wish we had time to talk about it, but if you just go home and Google Simon Linda and Mbube, you will get wonderful articles about the story of this song. I mean, he wrote it, he had the copyright to it, but because it came into the United States as a folk song, everybody recorded it. They thought it was, you know, a South African folk song. So there was no copyright. There was no attribution, no nothing. And after he passed, his family said, "This isn't right." And they hired a lawyer, and they have been able to get royalties paid in arrears for the use of the song over many, many years. But it's a fascinating story in and of itself. So Mbube is the root of what Ladysmith Black Mombasa does. And it's a more energetic, it's a louder, a more high energy version of what Ladysmith does. So Gooch, could you please And this is the original version. Was it 1937? Gooch, can I get you to move to the next one? So this is Solomon Linda and the Evening Birds, which I think is one of the more elegant names for a group I've heard. I tried to get these without ads, but I couldn't. I apologize.
Right, this is from that great tune, Next in the Sky, Robert.
So this is the Tokens. This is how most Americans, either the Weavers version or the Tokens version. This is the sort of doo-wopped up version. Can you take us to the third one? This third one is Ladysmith Black Mombaza doing it in their style, in the Isakatamiya style. So you can hear the evolution of this tune a little bit. You can hear the original as it was written and performed, and then the heavily Americanized version. They still got part of it right. You know, they still got the lead singer in this style is usually always a tenor or singing a higher voice, and a lot of the backing voices are bass voices or baritone lower male voices. So they got that part right. And they did pick up the tempo quite a bit, if you notice that. And then Ladysmith takes it back to a slower tempo. And also, it's a lot softer and it's a lot more gentle. So a little bit about where Mbube went. So it turned into Isakatamiya. And this is a form that's been around since the mining camps, that was developed in the mining camps. But Ladysmith really took it and redefined the genre and made it very sophisticated. And the word comes from a root that means to step lightly or to stalk like a cat. And it has to do with the footwork that you saw in the opening that you saw Ladysmith doing. And we'll see a little bit more of that. And you'll see them doing it during the performance as well. And if you'll notice, too, folks who sing in this style traditionally wear white shoes because it emphasizes the footwork. And it really helps you look at what they're doing because, again, it's soft and it's sophisticated. Occasionally you'll see big movements, but usually it's a movement, very careful footwork where the toes and the feet just lightly brush the floor. And it really does combine the best of male a cappella singing with this athletic but still very graceful dance style. And as I mentioned, this did come out of the mining camps and manufacturing camps that were established as early as the 1860s. And by the early 20th century, many of these camps were having weekly contests of singing and dancing. These workers would work 6 days, and on Sunday, they would often gather to entertain themselves. And a lot of these folks were homesick. They didn't get home to see their families very often, but it let them come together, entertain each other, blow off some of the stress of these hard hours of work away from their families. And by the mid-20th century, these contests had started going back to the workers' hometowns. And this is where Joseph Shabalala, who was the founder of Ladysmith, got his start. Ladysmith got its beginning in the early 1960s. And Shabalala had been singing Mbube style with mostly with his family members. And he had a dream about creating a softer, more refined version of that music. And that's very much where he went. And he named the group Ladysmith Black Mombasa. And Ladysmith was a township name. Black refers to the ox, which is considered the strongest farm animal. And Shabalala was an old farm boy. And Mombasa means axe, because they cut down their competition. They were strong and they cut down their competition. The group started performing in local competitions and eventually was banned from competing because they won and they won and they won. And they were welcome to come and perform, but they weren't allowed to compete. And this was very much during the period of apartheid. And I don't know if some of you have had a chance to either look on the Clowes Hall website and follow some links, or on the Nouveau website. But Nouveau has pages that it calls cultural manifestos, and they have a cultural manifesto about South African music, and they have a lovely set of talks that they've done with various folks associated with the group. And they were interviewing one of the group members, and he said in the early days that a very friendly man, who today we would call, you know, a groupie or a fanboy, approached him and said, "I love your music, I want to travel with you." And Ladysmith, being friendly and enjoying people, they said, "Sure, come on," and they took him in the van with them, and they traveled with this man for about 3 months. And then one day, he went to them and he said that he was a government agent, and that he had been sent to check them out. And he said, "You know, you're not terrorist, and you're just here to sing your music, so you guys are okay." And he left. So we can't say that about some other artists. Some other artists, like I said, especially folks like Mary Makeba and Kumasi Kela and even Johnny Clegg, have been and were in and out of hot water, were in and out of jail, were basically banned by the country. If they came back in, they would be arrested. So politically, there was a lot going on with music, but Ladysmith managed to rise above that, if you will, just by being themselves and by offering this music, this really incredibly rich music. So they were able to avoid a lot of the travel bans and problems that other musicians and activists had. So they began touring in townships. Then they were given an opportunity to tour in Germany, so they were getting some international exposure. But in 1986, Graceland really introduced Ladysmith to the world. And I talked a little bit earlier about the controversy about that, why the concert itself had to be held in Zimbabwe, and how Paul Simon took a lot of heat for that. But at this point, they had become known internationally because of this really incredible work that they did with Paul Simon and with Graceland. They won a Grammy in 1988. They went on to work again with Paul Simon. They worked with a number of leading musicians, including Michael Jackson, Stevie Wonder, Dolly Parton, Melissa Etheridge, and just about anybody who's everybody. Their music has appeared in a lot of different places. Said our young folks heard them in Lion King. The first time I heard them in a TV commercial for Lifesavers, I knew they had made it. They had become ubiquitous. And also in Great Britain, their music was used by Heinz to sell Heinz products and canned beans. So they were out there. They also accompanied Nelson Mandela to accept the Nobel Peace Prize in 1993. They sang at his inauguration in 1994. Mandela called Ladysmith South Africa's cultural ambassadors, and that is their intent, to travel the world and to spread South African culture and peace. Could you go ahead and play this next one? This is a tune called Hello My Baby. And when they get to a heavy choral part, I will let you know, but think about this chord structure, because this chord structure is a basis for a lot of South African music. Watch their footwork.
I don't mind.
So if you want to see more of this, go rent Graceland, buy Graceland, find Graceland. Again, the footwork, these groups are traditionally all male. They dress alike, so they present a unified front. And again, the white shoes, so that you can really, really see the footwork. The thing that blows my head about that footwork is it's not synchronized with the singing. And that takes a huge amount of whole body discipline to be able to do that, to be able to sing one line and dance another, basically. So I think the next genre I want you to have just a tidbit of a taste for, because some folks are aware of this, is gumboot dancing. And again, this comes out of the mine culture, because, you know, mines are full of water, and the workers were wearing gumboots. So this is called Iskathulo, and again, I'm horribly mispronouncing this, but there was a Broadway musical called Gumboots and was full of gumboot dancing, and it's even influenced the African-American step tradition. So there are step groups now that are doing gumboot dancing and doing it very much in this style. So could you go ahead and roll that? These are just guys dancing on the street, obviously. This isn't a formal performance. So you can see they're using body percussion, they're using vocals, and they're using the boots themselves both to stomp, and they're also playing the shafts and the tops of the boots, because they also have a really cool sound. So okay, thank you very much. And the last style I really want to talk to you about is Imbakanga. And this is a style that Johnny Clegg is known for. And he, Imbakanga really is a genre of jazz that developed out of an African take on big band jazz. Big band jazz went all around the world in the 1920s and 30s. And during apartheid, though, it really affected jazz players, because they were no longer able to play in mixed race groups. So a more African version of big band jazz developed. And it literally means like homemade cornbread or daily corn porridge. So it's very much a homemade product or a home product. You'll also hear it referred to as township jive or sax jive or even African jive. And it's vocal and instrumental. It almost always has an electric guitar, as you saw in the opening tune, Township Jive. So electric guitar, a bass, a drum set, saxophones, and sometimes you'll have trumpets or flugelhorns and other brass. And the Mahatela Queens are a really well-known group. And also, Miriam Makeba was an early practitioner of Imbakanga as well. And Johnny Clegg is considered by many people sort of a neo-traditionalist. He's a neo-Imbakanga musician, because he adds this American soft rock guitar balladry, things like that. And because his guitar style is more American, is more rocked up than it really is an African style. So a little bit about Clegg in general. He is an anthropologist. He's a singer, songwriter, dancer, and definitely a musical activist. He has a multicultural background. He was born in England to a multicultural family. His family moved to South Africa when he was a child, and he discovered Zulu music and dance. He was immediately fascinated and began studying and practicing. And this music and dance became so deeply ingrained in him as a practitioner that he soon became known as Le Zulu Blanc, or the White Zulu. And he went on to study and teach anthropology. So here he is, practicing musician and dancer, but he also studied anthropology to get another viewpoint on it as well. And he also created two biracial bands that were both illegal under apartheid. Jaluka, which means sweat in Zulu, and also Savuka, which means we have risen or we have awakened. So again, Clegg caught a lot of heat because he was creating and playing and touring with these biracial bands. He also writes lyrics that are in both English and in Zulu, and he also incorporates a form of Zulu foot stomping dance in Dlamu into his shows. So his stuff has been wildly popular in France. For some reason, the French just adore this man. In 1988, to give you some idea, Michael Jackson was supposed to have played a show in Lyon, France, the same night as Clegg. And Michael Jackson had to cancel because Clegg outdrew him so badly that Jackson would have had to take a bath on the door for the night. And the next day, there was a headline in a French paper that says, "White man singing black music outdraws black man singing white music." And by the late 1980s, the political climate had made it possible for him to tour more freely, and he became known to more European and American audiences through tours and TV appearances. I think what really put him on the radar in America was he was on Johnny Carson in 1988, and it just totally blew people's heads. His music is political, both in the makeup of his bands and his song lyrics, and again, during the apartheid years, his shows were often broken up, and he and his band were harassed. So what I'd like to play for you now is his appearance on the Johnny Carson show. And this probably was the first time people had really even seen any kind of African dance, for that matter, too. So it wasn't just the music. I think the dance is what really, really grabbed people's attention and made them aware. I left out the Mahatela Queens. We'll have to go back and catch them. Yeah, we need the one before this. And while we're still getting this set up, a little bit more about contemporary styles. Music is changing. Popular music, like it is everywhere, is changing very quickly in South Africa. But other styles that have been popular. Here we go.
Joe, Michelle, Hutchins. Oh.
Even nope. When you're not awesome, your immune system is. Support your awesome immune system with Airborne.
I really tried to find ones without ads. It's not always possible.
Okay, I think we're going to enjoy it. Good. Some of you Some of you may not know my next guest, but they've become tremendous stars in their native South Africa, despite the fact that by performing together, they broke the apartheid laws there. And their music has hit the top of the charts throughout Europe and is really catching on in this country. They're going to be performing in Minneapolis at the Orpheum Theater on the 26th of this month, and in Chicago at the Riviera Theater on November 29th. This is their new album called Shadow Man. Would you welcome Johnny Clegg and Savuka?
That's a little bit of Clegg's first performance, the performance that really introduced him to a lot of Americans. And again, the singing and dancing simultaneously. And if you noticed, some of the dance movements here are much bigger, but they're similar movements to what you see Ladysmith doing. But with Ladysmith, they're closer to the ground and they're more refined, but still wearing the white shoes so folks can see what's going on. And you know, this is a very poppy sound. His sound is changing. And it's a little less poppy now. It's a little more aimed towards rock ballad, I would say. So I have no idea what we're going to hear next Friday night. I have no idea what the band's sounding like right now. He has toured recently around the United States and Canada, but I think he is rocking things up a little bit more than going to the pop side of the force like he is here. And because we're running out of time, I do want to very quickly mention, again, some contemporary styles. Reggae has had popularity in South Africa. Soukous, which is sort of a Central African style. Soweto soul, bubblegum, which is Afro dance pop. Kwaito, which is basically the equivalent of house music or rap. And there are a lot of genres, again, that are combining and recombining traditional South African and popular musics with other African and world music genres. So the best advice I can give you is just stay tuned, because there's going to be always, always fascinating and wonderful and highly listenable music coming out of the southern part of the continent and the rest of the continent as well. So what I would like for us to do, to close real fast, and then we'll do questions. We are going to play The Lion Sleeps Tonight and sing it. And to do that, I need six people at each of these chairs. So if you could come stand behind each of these chairs. 18 volunteers. It's easy. It's easy. I promise. Younger people are welcome to come, because younger people are not as inhibited as some of us older ones. And grab your boom whackers. Put the low boom whacker in your right hand and the high boom whacker in your left hand. The low boom whacker is the longer one. Except for the people down here with the purple ones that say B on them. Those are the low ones now. The B's should be in your right hand. So what we're gonna do. Long one right, short one left. Long right, short left. And this is what we're going to do on the back of the chairs, and I want everybody to do this on your knees, too. Please do this on your knees. We're just going to start playing. We're going to start playing lightly. We're going to play right, right, left, left, 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 right, right, left. Lovely. Okay, we got that. Okay. So, a lot of South African music, a lot of everybody's music, from Bach all the way to the most contemporary rock and roll, is made up of three chords. And this is our first chord, right here. This is going to be our second chord, and you folks have got our third chord. So the pattern for this is going to go, we're going to go two rounds, one round. And a round is this. A round is simply right, right, left, left. So that's a round. So this group is going to go right, right, left, left, right, right, left, left. Then you're going to go right, right, left, left, right. And you do it twice and stop. So go right, right, left, left, right, right, left, left. And you stop. And then you go right, right, left, left, right, right, left, left. Then you go right. No, not yet. I'm sorry. Bad pointer. Pointing malfunction. Then back to here, right, right, left, left, right. Then right, right, left, left, right, right, left, left. Okay? So we're going to go about one, two, ready, go. Right, right, left, left, right, right, left, left, right, right, left, left, right, right, left, right, right, left, left, right, right, left, left, right, right, left. In the jungle, the mighty jungle, the lion sleeps tonight. In the jungle, the mighty jungle, the lion sleeps tonight. Weem away, weem away, weem away, weem away, weem away, weem away, weem away. I'm sorry, I screwed up. Weem away, 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 weem away. Near the village, the peaceful village, the lion sleeps tonight. Near the village, the peaceful village, the lion sleeps tonight. Weem away, 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 weem away. Hush, my darling, don't cry, my darling, the lion sleeps tonight. Hush, my darling, don't fear, my darling, the lion sleeps tonight. Weem away, 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 weem and roll. Woo! Give him a hand. Thank you. Now, hopefully, none of you will ever forget that chord progression. Ever, ever, ever again. And thank you to all the folks who were brave enough to come up here and do that. It was wonderful. We're taking it on the road next week. Questions, comments? There are some people in this room who know more on this topic than I do, and so please feel free. Comments, questions? Feel like you've got a little bit better chance of... Was it, the song that was played, was it Hello My Baby? The only, it was the first one, is Township Jive. That was the first one. And then I played their version of Mbube, and then Hello My Baby. Other questions? Comments? Yes, ma'am. I have not, but I would love to be able to. I think most of us in this room would love to be able to. It's on the bucket list. Like I said, there are people here who have more direct experience than I do. Other questions? Yes, sir. Why, obviously, our next opportunity is going to be, what, Friday night the 14th, when Ladysmith Black Mambazo and Johnny Clegg are going to be here at 8 o'clock. I am also going to do a short pre-show talk, but because you've been here, you can just go straight upstairs to the auditorium and skip it. And the folks there will not have a chance to play Boomwhackers either. So as far as I'm concerned, you came to the right talk. Other questions? Comments? Thank you all for coming. Be safe going home. And hope to see you at the Ladysmith and Johnny Clegg concert.